tonight.
Yes.
But before we get going, we've got to take care of some housekeeping, so to speak, the legalities. Mm-hmm. Our goal is to take this show on the road.
Yay.
So we've got to be very protective about our content and what we're talking about here and the things that are proprietary. So please, no recording, as tempting as that is. We'll do the social media posting and all of that, so you'll be able to see yourselves. But for tonight, we're just going to ask everybody to sort of keep it close to the vest in terms of some things. But I think you're going to get a lot out of it. I know that Misty speaks from a place of truth, and I'm excited. So without further ado, Misty Eastman.
Oh my gosh, I just have to breathe. I'm a quick runner because of the winner. Don't quit on themselves. Love this song. You hear the words? Does everyone know the words to this?
Yeah.
If you don't, you gotta listen to it. Freedom. I'm a quick runner because of the winner. Don't quit on themselves. Thank you. Okay. Where do I begin? Good evening. I'm so glad you guys made it. I know it's a nasty day outside. I'm here, you know, and it's a great atmosphere and it's nice and cool. I've got lots of notes to share with you guys, so bear with me, but I definitely want to make sure that I share specific points with you guys. So I'm Misty. Some of you know me, some of you may not know me. Some of you may think you know me, but you really don't know the darkness, and I'll be talking about that. I am an actor, I'm an artist, I am a lover of love, I am a soldier of love, I'm a transformational coach, and I stand here in my own truth. I am a survivor. I'm talking blood, sweat, and tears, and we'll get to that. We will definitely get to that. I'm standing here, and I realize that I've been in the darkness, and I felt like I lived in the darkness. I felt like I was Bane from Dark Knight. Hasn't you seen Dark Knight?
Born in the dark, raised in the dark.
That's how I feel. Like, I have definitely just grown into another person. My rebirths, people who follow me, it's like Rebirth Reloaded, Rebirth This. You've seen that. You've seen me pull myself up, and I've been really transparent in doing that. And when you walk away from here tonight, today, I hope and pray that you are empowered in some way to dig and pull yourself out of that sunken place, to dig, to pull yourself out of that darkness, and also to feel really empowered to start to look at yourself and look at your goals, look at your dreams, look at things that you never thought that you could do, because it's in the darkness where we really start to discover. And that's where I really found where my superpower was, is love. Because every time I was in that place, and every time I was so deep in that dark place, love for myself, well, love for others is actually what catapulted me out of the deepest place. But then I realized I had to love me in order to continue to pull out of there and start to heal. So, what I do want to share is, The whole point of me even bringing us all here tonight is I want to do this together. I feel like when I share, other people are maybe not so afraid to share. When I share my trials and tribulations, and then I share my wins and successes as I'm still trying to practice what I preach, and we do it together, I feel like tonight with us all being here, are we willing to grab fear in one hand?
Yes.
Yes. And grab courage in the other?
Yes.
And jump and grow wings together? That is my hope for us, is to do it together. And hey, if you can't do it with someone, then do it by your damn self. Jump then. Have you ever felt alone by yourself? I have. Have you ever felt paralyzed by fear? Have you ever felt like you had goals and dreams that you wanted to do and you see other people doing it, but then you've gone through something and you're stuck? Have you ever felt stuck in a job that you don't like? Have you ever felt stuck in a relationship that you're not happy with? have, I know for me, in a job that I don't like, I'm not even gonna go into it, but I'm an actor, I'm an artist, I'm a person that loves to create. But then you find yourself doing jobs that because you gotta survive. But what we do after that is what helps us thrive. So you work a 9-to-5.
Hello,
please have a seat.
Hi.
Welcome.
How are you?
Welcome to What's Your Superpower? We have more people walking
Great.
In who are late. I'm so happy
Hi,
to see you.
Missy.
Hello, darling.
Great.
You're right here on time. You're
yes.
right, you're right on time.
I was running.
It's fine. Pick a seat where there's a bag.
Yeah.
And we're just at the beginning, and I'm just sharing. And as you know, the person just walked in that when I get to that part of my story, she can relate to, she knows that part of my story, so I'm really touched by the fact that you came.
Of course.
Thank you so much.
I'm here because he will be here.
He's here. Thank you so much. I love you for that. Thank you. I appreciate that.
So
have you ever felt paralyzed? Have you ever felt like you were in that pain and people around you have seen you not moving? People have seen you not breathe. People have seen you drink yourself to a point where you couldn't numb the pain. Have you ever felt that loss? Think about it. You lost your home, you lost your job. My sister just lost a job that had her at, she was over 3 medical centers. She's, and right after she lost her job, she had other loss. So I'm asking you these questions just to put you in that space of really knowing that we could be completely incapacitated. But then we can think to ourselves, what could pull us out of it? What could save us? And only we can save ourselves. And that's the thing I had to find. But I had to find that the second or third go around. What saved me was me. So I felt that. I felt stuck. I felt paralyzed. I felt so depressed. I'm recovering now. You know, I'm standing here now. I'm on a 21-day mental diet now. I'm on a physical diet.
Yeah.
Whatever. But you know what I'm saying? I'm standing here, and as a testament to me too. And I like to say that because when I say me too, I say that to women, but there's men too. I've had so many men reach out to me. One called, he couldn't make it tonight. He was stuck in Boston, but he was trying to get here. He's a writer. He's done so many different things. And he was just like, me too. You know, it's not just the women. I said, well, then me too. It's a me too movement. So I have been. So when I propose that question to you, have you ever? I have too. 2014, August 15th. 5:30 p.m., packing up my apartment, we're getting ready to move, I'm with the love of my life, here I go, you know, house packed, and he runs out, he's going to go have a smoke, leaves the door open. 20 minutes later, I get a phone call. Michael's been shot. Some people know him as Noxie, has been shot. What do you mean? Life as I knew it at that moment, it was over. Once they told me he was shot, my whole everything, I was no longer who I ever was before. You can see me. Remember I said blood, sweat, and tears? I ran from the house. Sweaty, I was in a lot better shape then, but I was running. I got there. I made it to the scene. I get to the hospital. Remember I said blood, sweat, and tears? He was the blood. I was the sweat. We were the tears. There was a dry tear on his face. And you can only imagine my tears, right? But in that moment, there's something, I don't know what it was, and I keep thinking about it, I don't know what it was. I practically crawled in there, but I walked out with him. We walked out together. I've been there. Have you ever felt loss of? That's just loss of a person. When I posed that question, I said, have you ever felt loss in your job, and you're in loss of a home, loss of yourself? Have you felt lost? There's, you know, I had people dealing with addiction in my family. Have you ever lost your damn self? I lost my damn self. Okay, here we are. I'm completely broken. I'm in that something place. I'm in the darkest place. I'm in there. I mean, me and Bane were best friends. Me and Bane were best friends. That's when I started to cultivate that rebirth. I had a rebirth again. Because my rebirth before was all about my physical appearance. Losing that 100-pound rebirth. A lot of people have seen me do that. Okay, I got it down. I was in great shape. Okay, great. Boom, my everything is taken apart. Everything is blown to pieces. And I lose the other half of me, someone that I love more than I can even express. But in there, I started my rebirth. What am I living for? Okay. I remember you saying, Misty, if you die, I die. Then that means I gotta live. I gotta live. And I got parents, I got people to love. I gotta save other people. So I couldn't save him, so I have to save somebody else. So that's what happened for me. I fought tooth and nail with practices. I started physically trying to get it together, praying, meditating. I started writing down my thoughts. I pulled myself back together. And we'll get to how. And that's what I want to leave you with today, is the how, the things that worked for me, the things that I chose to do, how I reached outside of myself after reaching in myself, into myself, finding that love for me, cultivating that. Then doing some real technical things. Number two, have I ever been through the loss, right? I lose him, okay? I lost our home, our apartment. I couldn't pay for it all by myself. You have help, you can't keep a household without an apartment. So loss, I lost my home. I ended up being a roommate with my best friend, like a college student. I'm a grown-ass woman. And now I lost that. Now I've lost everything. I'm starting all over again. I had stuff in my cousin's house from a big, huge home where I was used to living, where I was used to, I lost who I was. Not lost, you guys. Lost. I lost who I was. And this is where pain starts to change you. This is where pain starts to turn you. It helps you find your purpose. And that's why I always hashtag pain to purpose. Pain to purpose. Good evening. Welcome. Hello. Thank you for coming. People are still coming in late, so I'm so, so grateful. We are talking about superpower, what's your superpower, and just when we find ourselves in that sunken place, and what we do to pull ourselves out of the worst places in the world. And I ask, have you ever just lost something? Have you ever been in the darkness? And I'm sharing with you, as transparent as I possibly can, that I have, but what I've done to be of service, to keep going, to have a message, to bring value to others, because my superpower is love, so I'm here to spread that with you guys, and that's what has helped me in my loss of someone being murdered, the love of my life being murdered at that time where I was in my life, in my place, and losing my home, losing everything, having to start from scratch, roommating with a best friend in a room as a grown-ass woman, like I said, to pulling myself back together, okay? I'm in the best friend's house. I'm starting out, you know, she's loving me to life. I've got my family here. I've got very few people, by the way, because when you go through things, you realize there's not a lot of people there, right? Who's there when you're really going through shit? Who? You see exactly who's there. 4 years later, there's somebody that walks in here that still keeps in touch with me via social media. I have not seen her, but she still checks on me. Because what we put out, we bring that. When it's genuine, we bring that back to ourselves. Rebirth. Here we go. Rebirth, rebirth, rebirth. 2014. I'm in 2016. I'm getting there. I'm getting back stronger. I'm still living with my friend. I'm cultivating myself, getting myself back going. I'm at a really great place. I'm auditioning like crazy. I'm an actor. I booked some really great jobs, voiceover stuff. And have you ever been in that place where you hit that brick wall and then you're feeling good. You're flying high. You know, you're on that flying disc, that really high disc. And boom. My mom gets sick. I almost lose my mom like 3 times. She was intubated. I literally spent 4 months. People thought I lived in Las Vegas. I spent 4 months in Las Vegas. Slept in the hospital with my mom 24 hours a day. We did a tag team for me to go wash. If I washed, because I felt like my superpower was to love my mom to help. I had to, and that's what we did. With the help of the doctors, with the help of the family. Love is what really helped save my mom in that sense. And I'm sharing my superpower because I just want you to think about what is it that is so powerful about you? What superpower do you have that is of service outside of yourself? So that's why I share this with you in that way. Mom's sick. I stay there as early as, what is it, 2016, December 2016? I have notes here because I just wanted to make sure I covered certain things. 2016, my mother spent all of December in the hospital with pneumonia. She has COPD, so it's a respiratory thing. And I slept there Christmas. My sister's three girls, we all were there with her. She got out January 1st, 2017. Now mind you, 2016, early in the year, I really thought we'd gotten to a great place. And, you know, we're there for Christmas. I got there December 2nd. We're gonna spend Christmas, boom, she's in the hospital. Just, you know how that meme says, just when you thought you had, boom, you get a knock in the face. That's exactly what happened. Boom. You just get blindsided. That's what happened. We didn't know she was going to make it. She made it. January 1st. I vowed to come back to New York and be in every movie, write every book I can, do everything I can do to be great so my mom can see it. You know how death makes you put fear in you? Like, okay, I got to do this. And my back felt like it was against the wall. January 2017. Okay, I come back. I bust my ass. I get back. I'm getting weaker, though. I got sick because I'm giving so much love out, I wasn't taking care of it. Got sick, but pulled it together. Linda knows this. I auditioned my ass off. I booked a show called Disgraced, which was it won a Tony off of Broadway. So it was really an honor to be able to do a play that was picked up by another theater. You know, when they're big plays like that, sometimes it's kind of funny with that. But got the honor to do that. I was really excited. This was June of last year. So came back from like January, busted my ass, booked a really great show, did that for 2 months. My mom was gonna try and make it, but we didn't want to push it. You know, so my whole family was really excited. Very, very supportive. And I say family because sometimes our family is not our blood, right? Sometimes people are just ride or die. And I have a few people like that with me, and those people are the ones that have kept me afloat during this time. When I got back, and I was like, okay, you know, we saved mommy for the third time. I got work to do now. Now I have to take care of me. 2017, do that, bring the show. My mom can't make it, my dad can't make it, my little sister makes it. She comes for the whole family. She comes closing weekend. It was wonderful. So I'm still flying high, just to keep you there. I'm still flying high after everything that's happening, everything that's gone on. She comes closing weekend. She flies back to Vegas. Before my sister came, I went there for Mother's Day. So that was really exciting because the Mother's Day before, my mother was in the hospital. So these are little things that are wins for us when we are in that sunken place with someone that is not well or with loss. So here we are. Mother's Day, I come back, I'm like, okay, I got my mother. That was May, June, boom, I booked a great show, so that's even better. You know, she got to spend it with me and my sisters, great. Last weekend, my sister flies back to Vegas. We closed the show, I got a lot of feedback from the show, so I'm like, okay, I got a new manager. So, you know, what you put out also is seeking you. You know that, I mean, I believe in the law of attraction. What kind of energy you put out, what kind of words, what you say, it comes back to you. So, 2 weeks later, I'm flying high, I'm getting ready to go to a film screening. My sister calls me. It's August 15th, because it was September 15th that Michael was killed. August 15th of 2017, my sister calls me that our other sister was rushed to the hospital. She stays on the phone with me. I'm on the phone with her, getting dressed, like, okay, panicking. I'm the person, Captain Sabo, that's me. So I call the hospital. I call different hospitals, I find the hospital she's in. She didn't make it. My sister, three girls. I got three girls, we're like back to back. She left 8 kids here. She wanted to make my show. She was like, she was kind of country, she stayed down south. So she was like, well, shit, I'm going to make it then. I'm going to come. I'm going to put these motherfucking kids in the car, and we're going to drive, you know. And I was like, Shannon, it's too far for you to drive from Las Vegas. Shit, it's a whole month, you know, hell. That's her. And I can feel it. It feels good to feel her like that. But she would have really driven across the country to come see me, but it just financially didn't work out because she had too many kids. My sister dies, and she leaves 8 kids. She leaves 3 babies. So I'm broken. I think I'm dead again. I didn't die so many times. Do you understand how many times? And I'm not even talking about the death of my uncle or my 2 aunts in between this shit. I'm talking about the things that I thought I wasn't, when I couldn't breathe in the dark. I'm talking about that pain that paralyzes you. But then you pull yourself back up because it's bigger than you. But this time, and this is as early as August 15th, 2017, I'm standing right here before you, what, 9 months later? I can't count to this. Linda can, my cousin's like a stickler with 9 months. Yes.
About.
So, yeah, about exactly. 9 months. So I'm standing here because of what I'm sharing with you. What I'm sharing with you is what helped me, what allowed me to come out of this, to pull up out of this. And losing my sister, okay, I officially felt like I'm lying there, and you're in the dark, you're in your parents' house, your mother's crying, you know, all of these things that could really just take you out of here, have you high somewhere, drunk, whatever, you know, but I'm there. Numb, yo, holding it in the dark, crying, but I'm to the point where I can't, I have no more tears. And the pain is so deep that it hurts to even inhale. But I do not want my parents to lose another child. You get what I'm saying? Like, if I die, I mean, they even lost another child. If I lose my mind, they lost another child. Then I was worried about, oh my God, I don't want my mom to go back in the hospital because she's stricken with so much grief. I had so many people to save that I had to dig, start loving me again, start finding that renewed love. Like, what is it that I can, I had to really, really say, okay, what are these techniques and steps that I preach, that I do, that, you know, that are really going to help me start to heal? What's good for depression? I start to really have to, number one, meditate. Number one, pray. Because we can pray, and I mean, I'm not pushing on you anything that's necessarily religious, but talking to a higher power, talking out loud, like, go, I need help. Please guide me in the direction of a solution because I don't know where else to go. Meditation, being quiet where I could listen. I had to implement these strategies because my parents couldn't lose another child. I couldn't lose myself. I have her little kids to take care of. I stayed there for 6 months in Las Vegas taking care of my sister's kids. My whole life here in New Jersey. Missing jobs, I lost two jobs. I could go on and on and on and on. But I'm still standing here. Because I'm like, I have people to serve. I got shit to do. So these steps that I laid out, and I listed them. I meditated and prayed, and I would just breathe because sometimes I felt like I couldn't breathe. I pulled out a journal because you know when you can't talk to anybody when you're going through something and they're just like, oh, you gotta be strong. You know what you want to say, right? Mm-hmm. I'll refrain from saying what I felt to say what I said, but I wrote in my journal, and the daily purge is what I call it. And you guys will all get through this soon. Daily purge, I wrote in that, and I called it purge because I had to purge. I had to write down my feelings. I had to use my journal as my confidant because there's some things you cannot express and you cannot say to people because they don't get it. It's too deep. And until they've gone through it, they can't even relate. So, number two, daily purge. Number three, gratitude journaling. Just writing, saying thank you because I woke up today. My sister didn't wake up. She went to sleep after dropping her kids off to school and never woke up again. So what am I grateful for? What can I be grateful for while I'm so sad and sorry? Would she want me to die too and not be here to take care of? I had to really put things in perspective. Sometimes we have to put things in perspective when we're in pain because we have to think about our higher purpose. Let that purpose be turned, that pain be turned into a purpose. That is so, so important. Number four, visualizing and affirming, listening to audio shit. I started trying to listen to people that had gone, I was listening to this book by Dr. Viktor Frankl, Man's Search for Meaning. He was in the Holocaust. He lost his whole family. I'm listening to people who would survive things worse than what I thought I was going through. That's the only way I could get a grasp on how I could get through and past. And with these steps, I'm telling you, depression does get to a point, and I'm going to say this, depression does get to a point where you do need help outside of it. You need a sounding board. I had 12 weeks of a coach while I was in Vegas. I reached out because it did get heavy for me. It was once a week, just somebody to be accountable to. And that's why having this, I feel like we create a tribe, we create a community where we have people that we can come together with and share. And I reached out to someone, and even since I've been back, I have a therapist, I have a coach, I have somebody that coaches me to my higher good, to my greatness. And that was something I had to implement. But but also the goal setting and my hour of power. I call it hour of power, but it's basically just waking up where you allow the very first 30 minutes to 60 minutes of the day, and if you only have 15 minutes because you have kids, but really finding time to dump. Like if you're going to a job interview, hey, write it down in your journal. Okay, I'm going to the job today. I really, really don't want to be here. But that journaling, that private confidant that you're able to, and sometimes you don't realize that you might reveal stuff that you wanted to do that you never even thought you wanted, that you ever even thought of. You might find out that you're passionate about something, like, God, I hate this job, but I remember when I was in college, I did this, or when I was in high school, I used to love to. When I was the happiest, what did I do? When I was the happiest, I did this, and it was not nothing like your life looks like right now. And I feel that those little steps of journaling, those are healing, to be able to speak to something and no one know what you're writing, no one know what it is, it's your private confidant. And when you take things out of your brain and you put it onto the paper, it's almost like you take that weight off of you, and it shifts it. And once you put it on paper, shit kind of gets real. It starts to come into fruition. And what I definitely want to step on, I know I'm just talking and I'm going on and on and on, but
baby, it's good.
I get excited.
It's good.
And I start speaking from my heart and just knowing that in those really, really hard moments, that those are key things that really, really, really help. And everybody knows, you know, meditation and prayer or something, it definitely brings you. But those, the technical things of really doing something daily, and I'm going to get to that. 21 days to create a habit, I'm going to get to that. But my thing is I can list all of those things, and I can say all those things, and I have to say this to myself. We cannot be, if we are passive on the advice, and I'm not saying this just to you, we're having a conversation here, right? I'm not talking at you, I want you to feel like I'm talking with you, that we are talking together. So if you have feedback, that's fine. But I'm having a conversation here with you. In listing those things, sometimes we are passive. We don't take the advice. We don't follow the prescription. Sometimes, you know, we know if we work out 5 days a week, we're going to lose weight. We know if we do this, that, or the other, or if we take our whole stint of antibiotics, it won't come back. We know that these are things that we're supposed to do, but we don't follow the advice of it. So how do we expect to get the highest level of results if we don't follow through? How do we expect to come up out of that darkness? How do we expect to reach our goals and dreams and passions? And some of us don't even know what those are. But some of these practices will help you do that. My cousin has been like doing so much. I mean, she's like a creative genius with so many different things. A lot of people here in Jersey know her. But she has had a whole career, and I'm using her as an example because I am inspired by her in the way that when she puts her mind to something, she follows through on it. And she's a late, I don't know if anyone's ever heard of this book called Late Bloomers. She is now a visual artist. I mean, these are not her paintings, but she's doing art. And I mean, I'm talking beautiful art. She has an art show coming up. And she's doing that now after a whole career working for a pharmaceutical company. She's had so many different damn careers, and now here she is, 60 years old, and now she's an artist. I tagged you in Swiss Beats. Right. But she stepped out on faith in the darkness of us grinding, and as artists, you know what that can be. She stepped out on faith, but she wasn't passive with her daily rituals, and these are the things I'm laying out for you. And everyone, like people that, if you've heard the success leaves clues, have you ever heard of that quote? Success leaves clues. Jack Canfield said this, Jim Rohn says it. He said, success leaves clues. Stand guard at the doorway and the threshold of your mind. Meaning that, you know, we're so busy trying to get everything else right. What about this? Because if our mind is right, our body, everything else falls into place. And these are things that she's done daily to position herself to be this flourishing artist. 9 months ago, I was crawled up in a corner. What did I do? Crawled up in a corner. I had to help myself. I had to take responsibility for my own pain. Go through these steps. Get here. Make it happen. And daily, though, that's the only reason I'm able to stand here. My therapist is in the room, right there. We talk about this. We lay it out. But you know what? That's support. And we need that. And that support, and that is exactly what we need at times.
Therapists.
But also somebody that's going to be there to hold you accountable, your friends, your loved ones, people that are like-minded. I'm here, and I always reach out. People reach out to me on social media all the time. Oh, my God, you really helped me. You supported me. And a lot of people that wanted to be here weren't even in the state of New Jersey or New York. So that really touches my heart. So this message isn't just for me. It's for us. So my pain and my situations are not just for me. It's for us. So I share that, and I share this prescription, if you will, or this diet for the mind with you, because that's the only way I'm able to stand here in front of you today. After watching my mom and dad bury their child, after looking at my boyfriend with 6 bullet holes in his body, after me losing everything that I had, and I started starting over and still going, still auditioning, I still have a dream. I still set goals, and my goals, one of my goals, I say to myself every day, I find myself to be, I am grateful and happy to be a working actor. I'm grateful and happy to be touring the world, speaking to people. I'm so grateful and happy to be lean and in shape. I'm so grateful and happy that I helped someone change their life. That's the things that I had to, because what we put in our mind, it feeds ourselves. It really, really does. You know, if you can tell yourself, look in the mirror and you're like, okay, I feel good. And then if you just listen to yourself, you know, the body language, you know, the physical body language, that helps you. And I noticed when I started getting up out of the bed, and if I was going to cry, I would stand in the window and cry. I wouldn't lay in the bed and cry. I would breathe one thing at a time, but I still took the prescription daily. That's meditating. That's praying. Maybe you're not into that. Maybe it's something that you are kind of against, and then pray. Then if you can't do that, just sit and breathe. Pull out your journal. You guys have bags here. There's little love goodies, little things that I'm anal about that are in there. I call them the Tupac journals, because when I bought Tupac's book, he had these journals in them. And I don't know, I just love the way they look. So I was like, let's do a guerrilla style and bring out the journals. But the daily purge, and I call it daily purge because I want you to write these things down. Purge them out in your book. You can go in your bags, yeah. And then we will get into our bags, you know, pen and paper. There's definitely pen and paper in there. But just to go back over this prescription with you, the meditating, the purging, writing in your journal, writing down your thoughts, and knowing that journaling is very healing. It raises endorphins, it raises neurotransmitters, because you can write down good memories, not only you can get the bad shit out first, and then get to the good stuff. You can write down your dreams. Say you want to start a rock band, you want whatever it is, write it, talk to your journal. That's what we have that for. That's one of the prescriptions. That's not terrible. That's not hard to do. You know, visualizing, really closing your eyes and seeing yourself doing what you put your mind to do. Seeing yourself doing something bigger than yourself. Because when we think outside of ourselves, we have the strength to stand here as I'm standing here before you today, as I'm still here. As I'm still practicing what I preach and teach and coach and share. But if we just implement these little things, it just makes a little change. It just helps with a little change in the goal setting. And like I said, in the beginning, when I was in like the worst pain of all, my goals were just to, okay, let me get out of bed today and stay out of bed once I drop the kids off to school when I was in Vegas. You know, when I was in that place, okay, I dropped the kids off. Let me go sit in Starbucks and listen to an audiobook on healing, on writing a book, on an actor that made it after drugs. I listen to people that have been successful after going through worse things than I thought. Okay, so that's the clue to let me know I could still be a success. These are the things. We all run into mistakes. I know we all do. And the mistakes, we all make them. And the mistakes are not following through with the whole thing. And what happens when we don't follow through with that prescription and is, like I said, we don't get our greatest results. And I want to really, really impress upon you and empower you to really, really think about taking action. You know, and for 21 days, join me. I call it the 21-day mental diet, and I got that from Brian Tracy, somebody else that is a very successful person. Because when we want to do something better, we want to level up, you can't can't look around you at people who are doing the same shit. You gotta look at people that are examples, that are doing something that you want to do. We have to model success in order to be successful. And that's in if we're in pain or if we're depressed or if we have some great goals that we want to make. We have to look at those who have done, who have laid out, who've laid it out for us. So taking action is huge. Action is the antidote to despair. You understand that? Taking action. So yeah, I was scared shitless to just get up here and spill all of this. It takes a lot to be transparent, but you know what, it feels good. But the action of doing it, I feel so empowered. I feel so full of love, and I want a hug from everybody when we're done, and I mean everybody. I feel like taking action, just, we stand in our power when we take action. And part of the transformational process is doing the opposite of what didn't work before. So as they say, insanity is doing the same thing and expecting different results. Let's do something different together. So, we are here. I want us to hold hands together. I want us to jump and grow wings together. I want for 21 days that we can agree, that we can commit to 21 days of at least three things. Waking up a little earlier, maybe if you can't wake up an hour or two earlier, wake up 30 minutes. Give yourself 15 minutes to thrive. 5 minutes just to write, I am, write thank you. If you don't know what to write, what you're grateful for, thank you. That's gratitude. Thank you for waking me up. Thank you for, I can walk. Thank you for little things. Be thankful for the things that we take for, thank you for the air in my lungs. My mother had COPD, she couldn't even inhale. So I'm grateful that I can we breathe in and, you know, just, that feels good, right? Thank you for that. So if that's all you can do for 21 days, when you wake up, early, that's number one, wake up a little early and just take time to write down 5 to 10 goals and write them down as if they have already come into fruition. I am so happy and grateful that I published my book. I'm so happy and grateful that I got a new place for my son or for my kids. I'm so happy and grateful that my practice is growing and I have new, I'm so happy and grateful that Swiss Beats, I won this Swiss Beats art thing. Shit. I'm so happy Mocha Lounge is so popping and we are just, I mean, so happy, you know? I'm so happy, whatever it is, write that down, but write it down in the present as if it's already happened. One of my goals, and I'll humor you, I'm so happy and grateful that I am a lean, mean boxing machine. I'm sorry, boxing is one of my favorite sports. So when I exercise, I like to go back into the boxing gym. So that's what one of my goals are, to get back in and train 5 days a week to get back to my fighting weight. So that's one of my goals. Write that down. The third thing, try to plan your day the night before. This way, and Linda's a stickler for this, she makes us plan what we want at Wendy's before we even get to the line. We're like, you know, so she's a planner. But it definitely, but right, that sets you up for success. So number one, we wake up a little earlier and we commit to that together. I mean, commit to it for yourselves as well. Wake up a little bit earlier, start to really, really, maybe just 5 minutes, 3 pages of just purging whatever your thoughts and feelings are. Then write, if you can't write 10 to 15 goals, write 5. Write something, but write it as if it's already happened, because when we see things from the future, that puts that energy out there and we start to attract that back to us ourselves. I put this out there 9 months ago. And I'm standing here, and it sucks, but hey, I'm still standing here.
Yes.
Write it down. Talk to yourself if you have to, until we can be here to talk together, until we can be here to have a conversation. And can I ask that we all take out our journals? And write down 3 goals that you wish to accomplish in the next 6 to 9 months. This way you can all promise me that you'll be back in 3 months so we can check up on those goals. Uh-huh. We can do this again and see. Yep, Linda, write down your Swiss beats. Uh-huh. Write your Swiss beats down. So, I'm leaving you with this challenge, and I hope that I started to just scratch a little piece of your mind to start to look into believing in yourself, even when things seem hopeless, even when you are in that something dark place. Believe in yourself and the beauty of your dreams. Okay, Misty, well, I don't have any dreams. I don't know what I want to do. If you start writing about when you felt good. Wake up earlier. Take 5 minutes to just purge in your journal. Write whatever you feel, whatever you're going through. Then make sure you write what you're grateful for. And then once you write what you're grateful for, write some of your goals. Even if it's crazy, even if you want to be president, write down. Yeah, whatever it is. Because until it's on paper, it doesn't feel real. And then you're accountable to yourself because it's on paper between you and your partner, your journal, and you are partners. So, okay. I know I've just been talking, but you guys are with me, right?
Yes. Okay. Yes, we are.
We were conversating, even though I was doing all this talking.
Yeah.
So I wonder, what have any of you identified? I know I filled you with a bunch of information, but through my sharing, what have you identified for yourself as your own superpower? And some of you may know already. I mean, Linda, you can start. Let's open the floor up.
Okay.
Your superpower. What is your superpower?
My superpower is acrimony. I'm able to see the best in people in different situations and help bring that out of other people.
Yes.
I think that's a superpower.
Yeah. Well, if that comes to mind first, that's what it is. Yeah, that's what it is. Anyone else want to share their superpower? Christina? But do you think that you can discover it? Can you write, did you write down 3 goals already? Okay. So before you leave tonight, write down 3 goals. And think about your superpower. What gives you, when you are at that, this is just food for thought, when you are at that place, that something place, and that, or even in a good place, but when you are in that place, what pulls you through when nothing else does? What can you tap into? What do you see when you touch other people? I am so grateful for you. You're very selfless. You're very giving. I met you how many years ago, and you have never stopped supporting me through all the shit you've been through. Your ability to be supportive of others, even in the face of, I'm just offering things, I'm not planting, but you know what I'm saying? Think about that. Like, what do people say to me? What do people tell me? A lot of people speak to me about my love. Nobody loves like you, Misty. You haven't been, you know, I love, I feel like you have to be loved properly. And I'm talking about any relationship, not just a romantic relationship, because I love hard. Once I love you, it's over. Sorry.
Sorry.
Ride or die.
Born in the dark.
You know, like, I mean, that's me. Like, seriously. So this will be very good. This 21-day mental diet, along with my other diet I'm doing. So we'll be doing the 21-day mental diet. And I'll be talking about it and sharing it on social media. But I just want you to leave feeling a little more empowered to tap into your brain and think about no matter what obstacles you're facing, you can still be great. You can turn that obstacle, turn that tragedy into a triumph, turn that pain into a purpose. You can do it, anything. Anything we put our minds to, we can do it. We have to take action. And action is the antidote to that despair. So I look forward to seeing you guys in 3 months. I'll keep you posted.
Yeah.
All right? Any more questions or anything?
Yeah, I like that.
Yes. Action is the antidote to despair.
Yes. I like that.
Great. Thank you guys so much for listening. And as I stand here with my notes, and thank you for coming. Thank you for your time. Thank you for your love. And thank you for your support.